Welcome to the latest edition of the Untitled Wrestling Podcast by SWN. I'm on a roll now. I've actually remembered the name of the podcast every episode this year for recording. I am joined this week by Callum Bruce. Welcome to the show.
Hello.
So Callum is a wrestling fan, of course. Why would he be on the show if he wasn't a wrestling fan? But we've kind of interacted on and off the last few years over Twitter, Facebook, just because we're
we've been mutual acquaintances for at least, it's at least 5 years, give or take.
Quite possibly. I mean, we've probably passed like ships in the night as well. It shows because you're from the Northeast. I'm round about there. Like I said before recording, I'm about an hour away from you, so we would have bumped in, I'm sure. At WrestleZone shows, however, when I go to WrestleZone shows, I have a face like a smacked arse and look like I don't want to speak to anyone. So it's just, could have been the reason why we've never actually interacted. But anyway, right, we've started off with a ramble. Let's get the first question out of the way, the boring one. If anyone watching the video, they could probably tell I watched a Broken Skull sessions very recently because I'm doing all the hand stuff. How'd you get into pro wrestling?
Well, I kind of had, it was kind of like a stop-start. So, primary school, the lads were in it, some of the lads were in it. I had the video games, I had the toys. Then there was an odd period where it kind of, stopped. And then it must have been just before, who was it? I'm trying to mind how it fits storyline. No, I can remember what the TNA storylines were, but I can't remember the WWE ones.
What were the TNA ones? I'll try and see if I remember.
It was when Austin Aries did the first option C.
Oh, God. So that's outside of my TNA remit as well.
The year of four, it was just before, the Aces and Eights started, so it's be 2013, 2014. So it'll be Mania 30, give or take.
Aces and Eights, what a time to be alive. So what was your first wrestling figure then? I love odd stuff like
it
that.
It was the Elimination Chamber, the massive 20-foot, the massive beam to the represent kit. So it had Taker, Batista, Mysterio, Cena. And I think it was the four that came with, and I can't remember the other two that came with it.
I think it was Shawn. Had just two big chambers at each side. Or actually four chambers.
It's like the 2010, mine, see how the old chamber was in 2010 and stuff. But from the original chamber, that's kind of what it was.
Yeah, my mate had one of those. It was humongous.
It was huge.
But I always finding out who the first figures was because mine were the bone cracking ones from back in the late 90s. The Draws, Ken Shamrock, Goldust. Every time I see them now on eBay, I'm like, don't buy it. You don't want it. I mean, I've finally bought myself a wrestling figure for the first time in God knows how long. I'm 30 now, so last time I bought a figure, I was 18, maybe? 18, something like that. So it has been that's when I went on a tear one afternoon with my mate. And we were let's get some wrestling figures. Why not? Because we were cool. I hunted high and low in Elgin for all five members of the Spirit Squad.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Oh, we were cool kids. And got them.
That must have been one shop.
No. I had to go to several. So I had to go to Argos to get a double pack, which was Mikey and the Big Show. I had to go to Tesco to get, Kenny. I think it was Kenny. Okay. And I had to go get a double pack of Mitch and Johnny from Toy Masters. And I had to go to Asda to get Dolph. Nicky.
Nicky, if ever his name was.
Yeah, that was a big time. That was a big day. Anyway, we're getting totally off track here. Right, so
anyway.
everyone that will be listening to this thinking, oh, he's super cool. But that's, I'm okay with that. So, Austin Aries, option C, that was your first kind of starting off with then. So.
That's when like, that's when I started getting into like weekly, like the TV weekly sort of stuff. Because I don't hate Sky, so like it was just either you chanced your luck watching TNA on Challenge, or for some reason you might hate, like, you might get the odd stuff on like YouTube and stuff, because like WWE put all the highlights and stuff up on it. So like that's it. So I kept on getting to that, and then I started watching like the pay-per-views. The network then started, so I started watching a little bit more frequently, and then knew since BT's got the UK rights, it's a lot more easier. So like, I'm trying to watch it religiously, but then with like the other commitments, like we might get into, it's been a little bit more suggestive of when I watch.
Yeah, I mean, my wrestling habits nowadays are just the YouTube highlights the next day, and then I'll stay up for the pay-per-view because I work from home at the moment, so it's great. And I can look like shit like this with people there watching the video. They've paid £3 for the privilege. So who are your favourites initially then when you started watching?
So when I first started watching, must have been, so that'll be when DX came back. So like 2008, so you're like thinking about 07, 08, when they had the tag titles.
Oh God, yeah.
So it'd be Mania 24, Mania 25, so realistically, it's your Cena's, your Shawn Michaels, your Undertaker's, Triple H's, blah, blah, blah. But then I got, who was it? I managed to get like the old, like the first SmackDown PS1 game. So like you hit, so then you start getting like the old, so like that must be now like the 2001 roster, just before the, I think it was just, must have been just before the invasion.
I think it was like, 2000, was it? Yeah, it must be,
yeah, 2000.
So you had
Austin, Rock, Hunter, Taker, all of the Attitude Era stars, and I just played the absolute shit out of that.
So just your classics then. Your classics were your favourite. Any odd ones, any odd choices, or like I don't want to tell anyone I like this guy or girl. Like girls, anyone that you're like, I don't want to tell anyone, but quite like them, like I don't know, Tajiri or Simon Dean or something like that.
Well, heck, I was kind of like, I kind of got influenced by the ECW, so it was always like Rhino, the Dudleys. You can mix in the Hardys, you can mix in Edge and Christian, you can mix in Rhino, Dreamer. Rob Van Dam, like all like the like anyone that ended up going through a table, realistically.
So yeah, Spike Dudley, for example. All right, so you're quite big into ECW. So I'm assuming you have the network also. Was that one of the things you went back through on the network? You went through to ECW and watched their old stuff.
I kind of just watched that. Well, with the stuff that I could get on the network, I tried to watch, but then, like, a lot of the fan pages on Facebook, like, were uploading stuff. So, like, one of them uploaded the whole entire 2005 One Night Stand. That's saved somewhere. Like, I think, like, there was a channel that I had for ages that was uploading, like, I think nearly, well, they go like through quite a lot of episodes of Hardcore TV, and then for some reason, then they stopped uploading, then uploaded every month, and then everything got taken down because of copyright.
Yeah, I mean, you take the chance, of course. I mean, there was a time there was a website called Stage View, and I would wait 2 days after the pay-per-views, and then I'd download them off there. But I've got the network now, so it's not as...
Yeah, I'm still kind of going through the dark. I'm still going through other methods to get the pay-per-views, because
well,
YP9.
up until this month, I was just hooking off my mate's account, and I had been for 3 years. And yeah. He messaged me out of the blue, and I went, "Oh, are you watching the Rumble tonight?" Hoping he'd say no. And he went, "Yeah, I think I'm going to check out tonight." I thought, "You dick, I'm going to have to buy it now myself."
You could have just done the Thunderdome.
I couldn't get in. I tried. I'd missed the email. It came in at 4 o'clock, and I saw it at 6.
Westy and Andrew got into it.
I know, absolutely shocking. I mean, I had a good run last year in the Thunderdome, to be fair. Yeah. I got into every pay-per-view bar TLC and a couple Raws, which was a fucking nightmare. I watched one whole Raw and one segment of Raw because I was like, what am I doing? Why the fuck am I watching this? I missed the one where that weird tag team bit happened at the end of New Day versus Hurt Business. And like weird, I don't know, count out or DQ or something like that. And it got restarted, but I missed all that because the match started in 10 minutes and I went, nah, I'm going to bed. That's it. I went to bed. I had a wee scroll through the Twitter at the end going, oh my God, I can't believe that happened.
Yeah. That's why big. Yeah, they were BT Sport. They hate everything on like the very next day, so that's what I know. So I just watch it in.
But no, it's yeah. Watching Raw is a slog. I mean, and plus, there's only so many times you can hear the boy over the. Or have you been in the Thunderdome? Have you had the experience yourself?
No, with the line I'm working in, I'm working like stupidly early in the morning, so there's like no point.
Means
you'd be in, it's like you're up until like 1 o'clock and then you're there for like until 4. It's like, no, it's like if I had to be up at like 5, no, I'll just wait and watch. I'll just watch it like every other person does.
Yeah, I mean, at least with the pay per views, it's only like maybe 5 times, well, top and tail each match, the guy going to go over the wee Tannhaug thing going. What do you think of so-and-so? React to them. You're shown. They'll see you. They'll see you on the WWE Universe Thunderdome. But the TV segments, it's just like every 5 minutes, and there's too many matches, too many segments, so you got to look excited. And you can't boo anyone. I've been booted out for booing Sasha Banks. I've got booted out for shouting, oh, fuck. So, and that was when Drew lost. Because I'm sure that is it. I'm sure that's what happened, because Drew lost to Orton at Hell in a Cell. I went, oh, fuck. And then I was out of it. I was out of the Thunderbolt. Yeah, well. I missed the last wee bit of Orton celebrating with the title because I fucking swore. I was like, if you're going to do shit like that, I'm going to fucking swear. Right. Anyway, as we always go off track here.
Just don't speak to me about my mania. Just don't speak to me about my mania booking. You might not be happy.
I will get to it. I'm sure we will, because we're going to probably, like I said, we're going to sweep past the Rumble a little bit, because like I said before the recording, you know what happens, but you haven't watched
it. I know what happens, I just haven't fully watched it yet.
Yeah. So how'd you get into indie wrestling? You said before we recorded, you're the indie guy in your group. So how did you start delving elsewhere?
Well, like I said, I watched TNA TNA was like the first company I've watched weekly, because it was the only company I could get. Then AJ left and went to Japan, and then because he made such a scene with Japan, mostly be we those boys, I kind of just like his match with Nakamura at Kingdom, like all highlights got put in, like all my highlights started coming through on Twitter and Facebook, and I was like, they'll fit. I'll try and see if I can find it. Found that, watched some of it. All right, a lot of it was in Japanese because they had English commentary, but the video of Hamza on didn't have it, so it's like, I'll watch some of it. So I watched like some of it, and then it was like, all right, because I was like, I must have been like, well, Holy Kingdom's was about 5 years ago, so I was in college, so like I was trying to watch it while doing college work. And then it got eventually to a point where it's like, this needs to go well, I need to focus on my work. And then, like, with the New Japan stuff, that led into Ring of Honor. And then, that's like all the, like, big indie promotions, the American promotions, that's just for, like, random stuff on Facebook that I've seen and on Twitter. And then the Homeland Indies is mostly because of McIntyre. Like, yeah, shows up in ICW, starts causing a scene. Okay, maybe I'll pay attention to this. And then along comes a guy, Faye Murray. And I was like, maybe I should be paying attention to him. I wonder who that could have been.
Well, it must be Bradley Poole. He's in his Lone Bride. Mayhem Brooks. That's his name. Mayhem Brooks. Mm. That's it.
And then, well, that kind of got me to like ICW. But then, if you follow my family tree, noob, there is some folk that kind of this. Scotty Swift is actually is technically my cousin. Like, his dad, or his, like, he's one of his parents is like a second cousin to my granda.
So it's in your blood. Wrestling's in your blood.
Yeah.
Diluted.
Probably.
Diluted there.
Probably. It's diluted there somewhere.
Drew brought so many eyes onto wrestling in Scotland. I mean, well, I started watching in 2012. So I've thankfully been able to see the... Well, 2014 he returned. So it was madness that he appeared.
2015.
ICW, and then he did his first match was BCW, I think, and then he did WrestleZone, and then he had his first ICW match. I could be totally wrong.
He had like one match in WrestleZone, and that was for the... That's when he was like Evolved Champion. Why did he face?
Andy Wilde.
Yeah. I was going to say, it was either Andy Wilde or it was... I was going to say, like, Crusher or somebody like that, but...
That would be cracking, Crusher versus Drew. I think that was the Battle of Nations match that year. Possibly.
It was Andy not representing England or something.
Yeah, I think he'd won he'd won the year before. No. I can't remember. I think he faced Johnny Lyons in one of them. Maybe the year after.
I'll need to look on Cage Match after this.
I'll probably have some information somewhere. I have too much knowledge about WrestleZone hanging about my brain and just
through
life. That's the one I speak about the most. But thankfully, I speak to someone up in my neck of the woods, so I can speak about it. And you've actually been to a show, which is
grand. I've been to the odd one or two.
I've only been
three.
No, Abbey Anarchy's then, I'm guessing that's the ones you've hit.
No, I was going to get that. I was going to get the two night one, but then COVID hits. I couldn't get it. It is mostly just been the Peterhead shows.
All right. Okay. So.
So I was at the show in 2013. Or 2014. So it was just, so I think it was the year X-Pac, was it? Anarchy?
Yes. Because that was the second year.
Yes, it was
Scotty as well. Scotty High versus Credo.
Yeah. So that was my first WrestleZone show. I then missed quite a few. And then I was at the fan interaction in 2018.
Is it Everini? Was it that one?
No. There was a fan appreciation night in Peterhead.
Oh, right, okay.
So I was at that show. That was my first show I took my girlfriend to. And then I was at the last show. I was at the show that they had in March. It must have been February or March. It must have been like their second or third last show before we went into lockdown. Because they changed venues because they spent like all the time at the Palace, and then they moved up to the York Street Hall, which is quite a small venue. It's basically like kind of like how a primary school's assembly hall used to be, like stage at the front, wooden floors. Mm. It was like that. It's quite a small room. So like due to the Palace, you could get like on average 60, like I say 50 folk, and then at the park, then York Street was about maybe about half. So I'm not too sure what had happened. Like I tried asking, like, oh, why you've shifted? Because like I tried getting tickets online. It's like, it's just like, oh, Russell don't Peterhead, right, buy tickets. I can, it's at the Palace, I can eat my supper there. And then it's like, oh, wait, you're actually at York Street. And it's like, so I said, like, from came in, it's like, oh, why did they change venues? And it's like, and they're like, oh, we done again. It's like management or something, they decided to change it. It's like, oh, well.
What is it? Did UPW run any at the Palace? I think they did, didn't they?
UPW ran York Street. They ran the community centre, and they ran like Bucky and Mintlaw and a couple of shows in Aberdeen.
Yeah, I went to the Bucky one.
So speaking of UPW, I only ever went to two shows. Now, if you check my Twitter, now you probably would have seen it through like Facebook and Twitter. I've got one photo with Colt Cabana, and I've got one photo with Doug Williams. So
those two you went to.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, UPW Doug had some weird then, guests.
Yeah, but then the Doug Williams one, a lot of the staff management actually knew who I was, because we had the group, because the SWN group chat started involving everyone. So, like, if they kept on going, I may have gotten involved. Maybe not physically, but maybe I may have gotten behind. I may have gotten
just doing something
behind the scenes. Yeah. I probably could have. Because, like, if we go, it's like I have on the odd occasion, like just for a laugh, like, oh, here's like, well, heck, here's Mania, for example, or here's what SummerSlam's going to be, blah blah blah.
Yeah, I mean, it's UPW was odd, definitely not disparaging them, but it was just the shows, the guests they brought in were just weird, especially for the market they were going for. They were like, heavily going for kids.
Yeah, because it was a different kind of show. Because when I went to the UPW shows, it wasn't kid orientated like WrestleZone was.
Mm-hmm.
Like every time I went to a WrestleZone show, it was always like primary school kids. But then it's like, they're all starting to get into it, and they went to just go to the wrestling. It's like, oh, here's a local show, we'll talk to you there. But then for you getting to the UPW shows, it's a lot more like older kids.
But I don't feel like they advertised it that way.
But it didn't advertise it properly. Like wrestlers, when you knew you'd get it, like you'd get a show nearly every single week, every 2 weeks, and the posters would be blooming that way. And then UPW, it's like, you had to pay attention to the socials. You had to, like, maybe on like, odd occasion they might put a poster up somewhere. Because the only reason I knew Cabana was coming is because right at the end of the road, on the green electricity boxes, oh, there's a poster. And I was like, and at the time I was getting into Ring of Honor, I was watching Ring of Honor, and I was like, why on earth is there a photo called Cabana in Peterhead? And then I was walking home from college, and I walked past them, and it's like, oh, Colt Cabana wrestling Mintlaw. And I was like, okay, is WrestleZone bringing Cabana back for a Mintlaw show? And I was like, then I did investigating, it's like, I said investigating, and I walked, then Colt did his art wrestling podcast, and I heard it, it's like, oh, I'm going to be in Mintlaw during the Fringe. I was like, okay, I'll try and find tickets.
Yeah, it was. I'm not disparaging them at all, because I enjoyed the shows when I went to them, Bucky. They were good shows. But yeah, when you're bringing guys like Bram
and their last champion bites five doors down from me.
Oh, the king himself, Chris Lamb.
Hmm.
Yes. That was his name. Yeah.
Yeah.
I should have called him the wrong name because he spent every show I went to, Bucky called me the wrong name, including after the... Well, that started because I went to the Lita Q&A at the Rocks Hotel.
I was wanting to get into that. Was it not midweek?
I think so. I think it was like a Thursday yeah. night or something.
I was trying to get it, and the only problem was I couldn't get tickets and I had an exam.
Well, I had one ticket, and me and the wife went to Aberdeen. Oh, no, I was just engaged at the time. We went to Aberdeen, yeah. And she was like, oh, I'll meet up with my pal. You go do that. And I was like, that's fine by me. That works. Great. So I got robbed at Five Guys, because if you've seen their prices, and then I went over to the show. But no, I saw it. It's so, again, odd. But I was... So that was the show. It was with Lita and all that. Great. Scotty Swift did the Q&A out of nowhere because he was told last minute that the host hadn't turned up. And so WrestleZone...
Who was meant to be the host anyway?
I have no idea. So WrestleZone, like, ran it. They ended up running it because whoever was running the actual Q&A went, ah, no, you guys do it. So I was leaving the
guys,
venue.
You guys came for your Dean. You've got the contacts.
You put up some banners. It's all good. I'll be fine. But yeah, when I was leaving, Chris Lamb was outside giving out flyers for their show that was going to be at the Rocks Hotel. So be a bit cheeky, but you know. And he called me Barry. And it really annoyed me. But no, I'm not really a confrontational person anyway, so I wasn't going to go, hi, it's Billy, you prick. And then I mentioned it on Facebook, and then every time I saw him at a Bucky show, he would call me Benny, anything started with a B that wasn't Billy. So I thought, it's quite funny and all that, but yeah. Still annoying at the same time. So went to the UPW, Mintlaw, two of them, one with Doug Williams. I'm just going to say the name because, you know, it's an explicit podcast, but they had Joey Ryan on a show. So they totally like they I think they were trying
that was weird.
They were trying to do what Discovery were doing.
Aye.
But they hadn't marketed it that way.
A lot of the roster was like reckless in Discovery. Lads though.
And SWE as well. A lot of them guys.
Aye, a lot of the boys, well heck, that's for like aye, but it's like there, a lot of them were for like Dundee, but then you realise like after the shows, oh wait, the boys that ran it, they're actually all local to like the Fraserburgh area. Because like Chris is from Peterhead, all the boys that run it are all from like the Fraserburgh Mintlaw sort of area. Because like, sure, was it Stallion?
Stallion's from Peterhead, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, he was like a security guard at the garden center. That's what I'm like. Hey, it's like I walked like the show was on a Saturday because like I went to the Peterhead show. Aye, because Peterhead show was on a Saturday because during Scottish Week. Went to the show there Sunday. I'm in the garden center, and he's on the doors doing security.
I suppose it looks a bit more intimidating when he had the bald head and the goatee. It's when he had the mullet. I'm just making.
It's like because I looked at him, he looks at me, and he's like, I was with my girlfriend at the time, and she says, you guys ken each other? And it's like, oh, he was at the show last night. Oh, he was at the show last night, blah, blah, blah. And I didn't really get into it.
Garden Centre. No, I'm thinking Dobby's. That's
no, it was Happy Plant in Mintlaw.
Happy Planet, the Happy Plant, yes. I used to live in New Pinsligo, so that's how I made the.
All right, okay.
Shithole.
Oh god, we've got one mechanic at work that says it is, and I kind of would agree with him because the only thing decent in Pittsligo, the only two things that ever came decent in Pittsligo was a Chinese anime host for tonight.
I lived there for about 2 years. I would never say I'm from there, but no, the best thing about New Pittsligo is leaving New Pittsligo to borrow some ashes in the way, but no. Yeah, that's happy plant, of course. an interesting place to go to. Right, so into indie wrestling, you're watching All About. How did Boom of the Banner start?
That was basically just a piss take to begin with, because me in one of my college schools said afterwards, when I originally started, it says nothing religious, nothing political. This is the first video we did. Oh, our views on the 2016 general, our views on the 2016 independent election.
Oh, you're just tapping both those those options straight off then.
But that was because in school, my last year at Academy, we did a mock election. So it was if you scroll right to the beginning of my Twitter, it's just an angry argument of the video. No, sorry, it's an angry argument. It was Aubrey that did it, Kent, each other. So we just had a really angry argument on Facebook and Twitter. And then I was like, it appeared on my timeline. Memories for today. And I was like, no, fair, I'm actually going to use that as content. And I just messaged him saying, Fitty Dean on Saturday, I've got an idea. And originally we had no name for the podcast, and I was going to call it the blah 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 show. I was just going to call it my name, and I was I need to actually have a gimmick name. And I was trying to think of something gimmicky, and I knew I was going to have to, if I couldn't get him, I'm going to have to speak to myself. So I was trying something wrestling wise. And I was like, you have going in Raw, you have Wrestling with Regret, you had all these gimmick, and I was like, no fit, I'll just use this. I literally put in Banner into a random generator, see if it comes up. It literally was going to just be called Banter to begin. It was just going to be called the Banter Show or something shit like that to begin with. And then I was like, we'll put this in. And it kind of just stuck.
So your podcast was initially about independence referendum and then went into wrestling.
That's what happened. The first show was that. Then he went to uni, and we could never, the times we would be off kind of conflicted. It was I was at college, he was at uni, we could never be off at the same time. And then eventually I just says, if you're wanting to stand back and just let me carry on with it when I've got spare time, do you want to do that? And he says, aye. He's like, some of the stuff he was getting into, he'd kind of go black on his socials for a while. And then I kind of thought to myself, right, if I want to make this a thing, I need to think of something that I know quite a lot about. I'm not going to speak about football because I know I'll be extremely biased and I'll only speak about maybe one or two clubs. It's no fit, I'll speak about wrestling because I actually know a lot more about that than fit I do about football.
Terrible when podcasts only speak about one or two promotions. That's just ridiculous.
But then at the time I thought, right, I know WWE, I know TNA, I know Ring of Honor, I know New Japan, I can get involved with the Scottish Indie, ICW starting to get big. Drew just won the championship. And I was I'll speak about these. And I could actually start speaking quite a lot of it. And then we went into lockdown. Then I had done it for a while. And then I kind of stopped and started with college and stuff because it was conflicting. And then I kind of just stopped altogether. And then COVID happened. So I thought, maybe. I didn't know at the time if I was going to get furloughed or anything. And I was maybe I should bring it back. Maybe once a month or something like that, just so I had something to do. And then we had that really, I'll call it the dark period that we had in the summer, where like a lot of folk got outed, and I was like, no, for a lot of this content in context doesn't, is not the best, because a lot of the folk that got outed, I kind of spoke highly of it, I kind of spoke like highly of them, just because of their in-ring ability, not the person that were behind stage. And I was like, I know if this sees the light of day, if some folks see this, I'm just going to get slated. So I was like, right, delete everything, clean slate, and we'll take it and we'll just leave it as a an ongoing project.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, if we ever decide, if it decides to have, we'll just make that as the lost season. So I deleted all of that. And then my hard drive decided then, we're going to wipe everything off. So I lost nearly everything. The only things I still have of the original is all the graphics and the title entrance in the title. Just because I managed to find it, like scrolling through my Facebook messages.
Jesus. That's why I've got the fear of losing episodes, but now I've put them on YouTube, I'm like, right, it's fine. As long as I can still download them off there, I'll be quite safe. But
I was considering like I can't imagine if it was like if I deleted everything off of YouTube or my hard drive, if it ever wiped first, I can't remember. If it was a hard drive, I was gonna just literally download everything back off of YouTube. But then when I go into YouTube, it says like, this video is not allowed in your country. This video has now been blocked. I was like, oh, what the f-? It's just because like this video has been blocked by WWE. I was like, oh, you f-.
Was it because of music you used, or was it because of
music? It was like music you used, imagery, a lot of the stuff was used like was custom made Titantrons, and like I did go and speak to the folk that made them, saying like, can I use some of your content in my videos? And he says, I sure you can, but make sure you add our like socials at the in your description. I was like, oh, no problem. Or it's like, add the socials in the description, at least say if you tweet it to you or whatever, at least put in our names as an attachment or something, just to say like, oh, thanks to blah 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 for helping out. So that's what happened. And now after, it's at least three, four years, I decided, I'm actually going to take the Twitter name up. I'm going to actually take the Twitter handle. And now, for the last couple of days, I've been attempting to start, kind of like what you've been doing, through lockdown with the Solitaire Classic. That is basically, what you've done over lockdown is kind of the reason why I've actually started it.
Don't blame me.
No, it's like, literally, what you and Adam have done over lockdown over the last year, doing the tournaments, I actually thought to myself, no fit, I'll actually date myself. Because, like, a lot of the groups I'm in, they're all, like, the YouTuber, like the big YouTube wrestling media groups. And I was like, oh, they've got like 40, it's like some of them's got like 40,000 odd, 40,000 members. It's like worldwide, include everyone. It's like, I'll actually do the World Cup. Because, and then I started it, got so far through it, and then I had to stop. And now I'm bringing it back, because this year is the fourth, it's been 4 years since WCPW defined, actually did theirs. So it's like, our World Cup's every 4 years? Okay, makes it's sense. Been 4 years. let's bring it back. Let's actually start and bring it back. So, basically, I'm using cagematch.net. Here's a list of every country there is in the world. Find a wrestler or wrestlers that will represent that country. So, for example, we'll take Scotland, for example. There's going to be heavyweight, junior heavyweight, the tags for each weight limit, a trios, an unders division, so 21s, 18s, 16s, and it'll be the exact same for the females, but there's no weight limits.
There's only two other rules. There's a lot of admin for it.
And the other two rules is they must have had a match within the calendar year. So with the COVID 2020, a lot of stuff. There's only a very narrow window for 2020. So that's a problem. Like, once I get to Scotland, there might only be about 8 or 9 females. But right. I'm not sure how up to date is cage match. I know they're pretty decent. And then for the Scottish males, I think there's roughly gonna be about 60. There's a few that still say active, but they haven't had a match since like 2013.
Hmm.
And I was like, right, you're out of it. And the only other rule is you cannot wrestle for WWE, but then I kind of do change it if you're the only one from that country or if you wrestle for NXT UK, because technically they still can wrestle on the indies.
Yeah, well, they maybe 2 or 3 companies that they're affiliated.
You can wrestle in Progress, WXW, and ICW. But it's like, technically you're still in the indies and you will actually face somebody that's not actually signed.
Hmm.
Like, Shaw will face Stevie Boy, or I'm trying to think of anything else, like Walt R, because he's WXW, he'll end up facing Bad Bones or somebody like that. I'm just thinking of anyone that's German by the time. But I got through quite a lot of it in the last, like at the beginning of this COVID lockdown, and then I stopped. And now I'm starting to bring it back, and everything's actually going to go on Twitter now, because it's a lot more, because it'll be a lot more easier to find than scrolling through half a dozen pages on Facebook.
Absolutely. I think for that as well, it's important to have folk in the tournament that have a Twitter account, because then that's the way to get some likes.
Yeah, it's not like I've already started for I've only got through to Argentina so far. And the only folk that's actually in the tournament of relevant name is Rezar of the Office of Pain, because he's going to represent Albania. And then there's only one person, then what else? There's one person representing Algeria who wrestles in France, but it's only got a Facebook. And then Argentina have started, and I'm about 50% of the way through them, and only one of them's got a Twitter. And they actually liked the tweet. And then I'm moving on to Australia, which should be a lot better, because a lot of them will hate Twitter. And I think the last time I did it was actually Mark Davis and Kyle Fletcher that ended up getting to the finals for the Australian tournament. But I can't remember that. But then, like, it was a lot of the group stages, I'll say, there was a lot of bias in it, because I did kind of tweak it, so it was like, Austria, right, we'll put Walter in. Canada, right, Kenny Omega's going straight in. I'm trying to think of what else.
You get some surprises, though. Well, because I noticed when we were doing
You do get some surprises, and that's why I'm putting it all on Twitter, because, like, I'm using cage match as like the defining. So, like, if you have actually had a match in the past, whoever's won, you go through. And then if it gets to a point for, right, there's a draw or no determined winner, right, here's a poll on Twitter. And then only like one person votes on it. and it ends up being me on my second, and it ends up being me on my second account.
That's the thing that I hated when I was doing the tournaments. When I started them, because I did the 128 stupid tournament of Doom, and I didn't let anyone.
That was funny.
Was just ridiculous. Thank God for Damien for doing the first promo, because that kicked off everyone else having a go at it. But
was the name Mikey Vigo that ended up winning that?
No, he got to the final. It was Grant McIver that won the first one.
Ah,
it was Grant Grant with the Saturdays against Mikey Vigo with all of his managers from previous rounds.
Yeah,
which I think Adam wanted to just break down after getting the message from going, all of my managers, please. Well, no, I don't want to. But no, Adam doing the graphics. I didn't ask him. I always said I didn't ask him. He just does it because he likes doing it.
Yeah.
So, but the 120.
The loon's talented.
Yeah. I mean, after I did that, of course, I let people just enter themselves, and it became more fun because they were up for taking part. I wasn't going to do it. I had a match with, I don't know, BT Gun versus someone else who doesn't use Twitter or follows me on Twitter, and I had like five.
Yeah, I think it was a female wrestler, I think.
Quite possibly, but yeah, I had no votes, barely any, because just they weren't taking part. They don't follow me, which they should.
It's quite sad. Yeah. It's like, it's not like I said another, it's like, folk, it's like, I say to folk, the folk I do my other stream, that I do the other podcasts with, which we might get into later, I says like, oh, does anyone ken this guy? And they're like, no, Fizzy. And he's like, oh, he runs the Scottish Wrestling Network. And he's like, oh, what, how should we ken him? And I was like, he's basically the Dave Meltzer of Scottish wrestling.
Oh God, that's a soundbite. I've been called that already. Bradley Craig, who does the Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame.
I'm expecting that to be on your Twitter bio by tonight.
I've been called that as well by someone. I was like, I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to do ratings. I don't want to be that guy. I barely like doing news.
We all know the Drew McIntyre Grado match is 5 out of 5 black puddings.
I've never seen it. I've only ever seen the reaction in the end. I've never actually watched the whole match.
I did watch the whole entire match I think ICW put it on their Facebook page for quite a while.
No, I've never actually watched it all the way through.
Oh, God.
I know, for someone who that's why I don't do ratings or any of that pish, because I have to find like little pockets of time to do anything.
We do have three jobs.
Exactly. I mean, the podcast I'm doing because literally my wife is working nights, so she is out of the house. I'm kicking about the house myself. What am I going to do? I mean, there's probably plenty of things I could do, but this is the cleanest. I could just speak to folk for a couple hours, and this is my mental health kind of release as well. I'm not a speaky person. That's how fucking bad I am at speaking to people. I'm not like a talkative person, but even I'm starting to find these lockdowns a bit fucking monotonous. Tedious. And I need to speak to people now, which is not a feeling I like having.
Yeah, that's why. That's a lot why. Kind of like why this other podcast idea kind of started. It's like, boys were just bored. It's like, we're all like wrestling. We're all like admins and moderators of the group chats. Let's just, so the brief history of...
This will be a last fan standing, won't it?
Yeah, last fan standing. So basically, you've heard of Adam Blompier, the guy that was in What Culture and went to call then Snell on WrestleTalk and did like his Quizzlemania quizzes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we kind of do our own version of that. So it started off. So it started off on. So the boys started it off on. Must have been just after Mania. And they just did audio, and it got to a point in, must have been after SummerSlam, where two of them decided no fit, Spotify, the audio's not working, let's move it to YouTube because we might actually get more viewership there. Because the only book, the only folk that was actually listening to the stuff was the folk that was creating it. And then they went to YouTube, and then they went to YouTube, and it started getting a little bit better. And then they said out of the blue, who wants to appear? And I says, ah, no fit, put me down. And then I appeared for an episode. And then I appeared for an episode. As a special guest, it was like right at the beginning, it was like the second to last thing they did audio-wise. Then they moved to YouTube, and then they were like, oh, we're moving to YouTube. Do you want to kind of show up for an episode? And I was like, oh, sure. And then from October, so that was like September, and then from end of October to the beginning of November, I never left.
So I'm kind of like once a month or once a week, just kind of time scale for it.
It's kind of like fortnightly. So, like up in, or it's basically just there's no like strict schedule. So like the boys will do live reactions to the pay-per-views. And it's literally just us bullshitting for about 2 hours, give or take, trying to do a quiz, mostly just arguing with Tyler, like, of, oh, I don't know, who was the first woman to be in both the men's and women's Royal Rumble matches?
Oh, you're asking me legit. All right, cool. That'll probably be Beth Phoenix.
Yes. And we kept on arguing it was Nia Jax.
She was the first one to do it one night.
Yes, but that's where I was getting confused. And then I was trying to do the admin behind the scenes. It was like, no, it was Nia, because Nia entered 21st in the Rumble, and then Beth entered 24th. So basically, Nia entered first, and it was like, oh, wait, the Women's Rumble is actually for the men's. Fuck.
So yeah, shenanigans then.
It's shenanigans. And it's quite a laugh. We're basically trying to do our own promo federation. It's the full title is Last Fan Standing. It's the Last Fan Standing Promo Federation. It was originally called the Cultaholic Promo Federation, but then we was like, no, we want to be our own thing. We don't want to be Cultaholic, that we don't want to be Diet Cultaholic, we'll change it to Last Fan Standing. And there's only like 13, 14 of us so far. No, sorry, it's 13 of us in a group. We hit to kick 3 boys out, and one of them's wanting to come back, but let's just say history's catched up with him a little bit.
Right. Okay. Just kind of hold
him
at arm's length and just
going,
no.
to an extent, but he is. Some of us want to make sure it's not going to happen again. Before he actually gets fully accepted into it, because it's like right now in the group, it's just pending.
Right.
Like you're not officially in the group yet. You're not officially back, but it's like.
Just thinking about it.
Because, like, the boy, like, there's a few of us across the pond. It's like, there's 2 boys in America. A lot of us are UK-based, and then there's 1 in New Zealand. But then he's, the lad, Sam, who's in New Zealand, he's only been on, like, once or twice in, like, the time difference. But, like, all of us being in the UK, we can say, right, we're doing it at, like, 7, 8 o'clock.
Really good to try and figure out from there. I mean, I know I did the podcast with Wrestling Gal. It was like, right, you tell me, you've done interviews with Scottish folk, you tell me the time to do it, because I'm not going to be able to work it out in my head. So it was like, it's 7 o'clock your time. Cool, that's fine. That's the time I'll be waiting for.
And lucky enough for the boys that's over in the States, it's like 9, 10 o'clock in the morning for them. So they don't have anything to do until about 1, 2 o'clock. their time, so we're safe enough.
Cool. So that's Last Fan Standing, if anyone's wanting to go check them out. So we'll go spring back into wrestling. Like I said, I was going to speak about the Rumble a little bit. So you've seen most of it. You know who won the main event and Roman versus Owens. So what were your thoughts of what you've seen so far of the show?
Well, I watched the highlights of the pre-show. You know, it's going to be interesting what they're going to do with Charlotte and Asuka, which may lead into a triple threat match at Mania for the title. Maybe. Unless they keep Charlotte or Wealthy Asuka in just a Charlotte versus Lacey, and he then do basically Brett versus Stone Cold from WrestleMania 13, the submission match.
But the problem is, folk actually have to cheer for Lacey at the end of it. I don't think that's possible.
They actually cheer for Charlotte because Charlotte's the Stone Cold character. Just listen. Lacey puts Charlotte into the figure four or something, into the figure four because she's wee Rick. But Rick gets so upset because you finally realise, oh wait, that's actually my daughter in the ring, and actually throws in the towel, causing Lacey Evans to actually give up instead of Charlotte. He throws in the towel because he can't see his daughter be in that sort of state.
It sounds a bit convoluted, so that means it'll happen. that's exactly what'll happen.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am not the illegitimate son of Vince Russo. Everything's not happening going on a pole.
I think there's a lack of pole matches these days, in my opinion. But there's so many little stories and tidbits. I mean, for me, Lacey and Charlotte should be fast lane and then forget about it from that point onwards. But
True, but then there's two nights of Mania, they need to fill it in.
Yeah, that's a weird thing. This year's WrestleMania, it's going to happen in Raymond James Stadium.
It's going to be Thunderdome again. Well, they're doing it. It's at the Buccaneers Stadium.
But it's still going to be the Thunderdome.
Florida can still have fans.
Yeah, it's actually amazing that they haven't brought in fans yet.
They've got a crowd for NXT, but
we're still quite far away
of what it used to be.
Yeah, but I just thought as soon as they had a sniff of being able to put anyone into the crowd on Raw, they would have been like, right, everyone, get in.
Yeah.
And just pile it in. But, you know, an odd moment of responsibility from WWE.
Yeah. You just know as soon as, fans at Monday Night Raw contract has 10,000 new cases of COVID. And it's like, you know they're going to get just absolutely slated.
Like a Fozzy concert. Things like it will be him being removed from the Women's Rumble. And then, of course, that meant Keith Lee was removed. Well, not booked for it either.
He was not booked for it.
They would have to.
There was some shenanigans right at the end. It's when both feet supposed to hit the floor. So I'm not too sure how they're going to bullshit book that reason.
Well, I'd do Rian.
Oh wait, her foot didn't touch the floor, it was still on the ring apron.
The Rock never won the 2000 Rumble, that's all I'm saying. He never won it.
True.
And they still say he did, and he didn't. It was the Big Show won it. He proved it. He had a little fat man in the corner wearing the flat cap backwards and everything telling them that the Rock's feet hit the ground. So they always find a way, don't they? But no, it was a really enjoyable show. I saw people going up about it was the best Rumble, but nah, nothing's topping last year's. Last year's is 2001's the best.
Is that slightly biased because Drew won?
A little bit, but I think if Edge won, or maybe not Roman, but if Edge had won last year's, I would have been just as happy because I just loved the way it was built up. It was unique. It was a unique Rumble, which is hard to do nowadays. have something unique, have a Brock just run through everyone. It was a weird way how they got there, how to get Brock at number one, but you know, that's just you take it off with
the smooth. I was actually expecting Brock to come back like last night, or at least like the like mainstream boy, one of the mainstream boys to come back. Where's Cena?
I'm surprised there was no Cena. Yeah.
Oh, but then Cena has came out and announced that he's filming in Canada and he's not actually going to be appearing on WWE television anytime soon. Somebody said to me, "Is Taker going to come back?" And it's like, "No, he retired. Survivor Series." It's like, no, will not see Taker come back. You will not see Taker on WWE television until Vince puts him in the Hall of Fame.
No, Undertaker will be back when there's a crowd. He'll get his one last farewell in front of a crowd. That'll be
First night in front of crowds. No COVID. Gong.
Yep. That'll be
What?
Everyone will be like, "Oh, shite, he's back." I mean, thank you, Taker. Go, do your Wii adverts. Yeah. Switch adverts. And for about Wii. Fuck, I've shown my hand there about age. I was going, "Wii, yes, that's the console."
I don't know where I'm aiming off.
I've got one. Oh,
the Nintendo 64?
I had a Nintendo 64 back in the day. Never played No Mercy, which seems to be sacrilege for being a wrestling fan. Never played No Mercy. And
because I was a PlayStation kid.
Yeah, so was I. I had Warzone, I had Attitude, I had In Your House, I had all that for the PlayStation, and then...
I had SmackDown and SmackDown 2, mostly because it was copies. I had Shut Your Mouth, so that had Rockin' Hogan on the cover. And I'm actually starting to play that, and I was actually starting to play that again, but then... That's at my girlfriend's, and because of COVID, I can't really see her.
Sweet. So is your girlfriend a wrestling fan, or is she just being dragged along?
She's starting to get in. Like, once I started taking her to shows, she started enjoying herself, because we're like, what's happened with her in the past. It's actually starting to kind of take her mind off things.
Hmm.
So, like, she can come along, she can have a laugh, and that's about it. Like, okay, WrestleZone's WrestleZone's the only stuff she's seen. Like, and she's watched, like, I think the only WWE show she's watched is NXT Orleans, because I was at her house over Mania, the NOLA weekend. So it's like, she watched NXT with me on the computer. And that was about it. And that's about it. But
no, that's the thing, it's the escape. Because, well, the first event I took my wife to was Regal Rumble. And we realised that she doesn't give a shit about ladder matches. She finds them stupid. It's like, ladder matches are stupid. Just get the ladder, go up it. Just, why are you going up one rung at a time? No point. Pointless.
And then you show her Mania 17. It's like, this is what a ladder match is meant to be.
Yeah, I've shown her that one. And Jeff Hardy, Undertaker, that was the other one that I've shown her. It's like, no, these ladder matches are good.
Yeah.
Just some aren't. But she loves the Rumble. And that's fair, because Rumble's my favourite. So I'm quite happy. If she comes to one show a year, it's usually going to be the Rumble. She stayed up for one WrestleMania, and that was night two last year, which was weird. And she went, "Right, I'm not gonna stay up for another show." And I went, "I'm gonna let you, but I'm not gonna insist on it until there's a crowd back, and then I'm gonna make you I'm gonna make you watch a Rumble with a crowd, because that's the one you need to watch.
That's when it's good.
That's when it's definitely good." But no, she stayed up because she wanted to see Edge return, because she. Like, when she was younger, like an old boyfriend, big into wrestling as well. So she knew Edge was and all that kind of thing. So
yeah, so like Edge. All the early naughty guys, like
she knew, well, she more knew the music, so she knew Alter Bridge, Metal Ingus, so knew that it was that was Edge.
I was so close today phoning up like North Sound to say, like, just to kind of take, because like one of the radio presenters is actually a wrestling fan, and I was like, here, can you play Metal Link? Just because, like, he says, no, I'm not watching the Rumble, I'm not watching it at all, I've gotten him, blah, blah, blah. And I was going to phone off and say, like, here, can you play Metal, just, can you play Metal Lingus by Opridge? Just to take the piss. Just to take the piss.
But no,
that's like the, because, like, that's one of the only wrestling, that's like one of the only wrestling songs you could actually listen to out with wrestling.
Are you saying you can't listen to Fandango?
Just because that got to number 29 in the charts.
It got into the charts. It's mainstream.
Yeah.
So does John Cena's amazing album, You Can't See Me. It got into the charts somewhere. It was amazing. I had that. It's scratched now. I'm fucking gutted.
Yeah.
I bought the explicit version as well. So I had all the spares.
Well, you get it on Spotify now, so you're all right.
I know, but I've got... The CD had the spinner. It looks like the spinner belt and everything. It was great.
Oh, God.
It was amazing. I was 2005? So I was...
Yeah.
I was 15 and I bought the explicit edition. Yeah, I'm that kind of bad boy. but yeah, I had that CD for 10 years and now it's gone.
You're just looking for the doggy and get to it.
I'm going to listen to that after this, I think. That's not right. wrestling, that's the thing. The wrestling is escape. That's what I've used it for years, since I started watching it. If I've had a shite day, I'm putting on some wrestling. If I've, my dog was put down. Not the one I've got now, if anyone's listening. Sandy's okay. But no, my previous dog, it was put down, and then that weekend I went to a WrestleZone show, and it was just what I needed. I mean, the photos say otherwise. The photos say that I look like the most miserable fucker in the planet, but I was happy to be there. So it's like, this is a picture of me smiling. I just look awful. That's it. Wrestling, best thing ever. Right. So other question I've got just before we ask. Before we do anything else and maybe think of winding up, what's your favourite dinosaur?
T-Rex, because
it's a classic.
Sorry, not T-Rex, Triceratops, because I hit a blue part, because when I was really little, dressed around like a blue Power Ranger.
I mean, he had the coolest name. What do I have thinking that? What are you wanting to see in wrestling when hopefully shows return in Scotland? Is there any wrestlers that you want to go, right, this is the guy I need to see? Like, for me, of course, I'll probably ask him Faith.
But... Well, I want to try and get to Anarchy. I want to try and get to the Regal Rumble. I was wanting to go and do the wrestling ICW was meant to come to the ballroom. Doing like that wrestle experience stuff, they then changed the dates to October, and then they've cancelled Aberdeen.
I was gonna say they've cancelled it. Literally cancelled it.
Proper job.
Was it the ballroom they were doing? I thought it was the Beach Leisure Centre.
It's
next door.
It's somewhere in that building.
Beach Leisure Centre, the coldest venue I've ever been to.
Oh, you have not been to some of the venues I've been there.
I mean, I think Elgin, Bishop Mill Hall in Elgin is pretty close. But yeah, Elgin, the Beach Leisure Centre is pretty cold.
I can't complain. All the games I went to was actually quite hot and sweaty. But then that's wrestling.
Oh, there's plenty of hot and sweaty fans in wrestling. I can attest to that. I've sat next to a few of them. That's your plan. So what? You want to get to rest. You want to get to any show that you can get to, pretty much, is the long and short.
Realistically, aye.
I'm hoping to finally do do a bit like a big the big four for WrestleZone once they come back. Abu Dhabi Anarchy, Battle of Nations, Halloween Rumble. Hijinks, and the Rumble.
Yeah.
Just hit all four. Because I've never been to a Halloween Hijinks show, but I've been to the other three.
Okay.
I've done Christmas Chaos, I suppose. They've got their big five. Six if you include Summerhill Showdown, I suppose. But yeah, I just want to go see wrestling. I'm fucking bored. Yeah. I want to go see wrestling.
Yeah.
I want to, as Big E would say, I just want to see big men, big beefy men slapping meat. I just want to see just folks smacking shit at each other for 2 hours live, and maybe you see Mr. Malice get thrown out.
That's why I watched the GCW 24-hour stream. God.
Oh, anyone who stayed up to watch that much wrestling—that's too much even for me. But I just want to go to watch live wrestling.
I watched parts of it, and then like, because they upload, because like I just watched it in snips, and I was like, oh, let's just see if I was on. And some of the matches were fucking good. Some of the matches were good. Like, I was like the first match. Like, there's two matches that I can remember clearly: Leo Rush versus Blake Christensen. This is, I think it was meant to be if Blake lost, he could no longer wrestle for GCW. And the other one I can remember, it's like, Shulk. He basically looks like he's tattooed, and he basically looks like an orc from Lord of the Rings. It's like that sort of vibe.
Right.
And it's basically him in a death match. And he just throws light tubes about. And it's like, okay.
Why not?
Why not? I've watched some of the crazy shit in ECW, and I watched like all of Lucha Underground in the combat zones. Like, yeah.
Let's go for it.
Somebody wants to like some of the stuff Mick Foley did in Japan.
Right.
In FMW. It's like, I thought getting chucked off the cell was going to kill you. Like, you should have died like 4 times in one match.
Well, a bit of C4 never hurt anyone.
Yeah.
Right. So before we wrap up then, who right now, Indies, WWE, whatever, top 5 favourite wrestlers, male or female? If you want to do separate
male
lists.
Male or female?
Whatever.
Right. I should go WWE and then Indie. I should really separate the two.
Whatever.
Go so, for. WWE, right now. Drew. Ha ha ha. Big E. Because, well, I can see a lot going at with him. Roman, that's just by us being champs, and we all know that. And I just want to see Roman Bryan at Mania. That's the only one. That's the only match I want to see at Mania.
It's gonna happen. We're getting Drew versus Edge, and I'm gonna love it. I'm gonna hate it.
No. We're not getting Drew Edge. We are not getting Drew Edge.
Look at fucking Orton Edge. I'm in for that.
We are getting Orton Edge for the title, because Drew will lose the title in the Elimination Chamber.
Benito.
And then Drew will end up facing Keith Lee or Sheamus or somebody.
Undertaker.
It's Fiend versus Fiend. Maybe.
That's the match Drew's been wanting. He's been wanting Undertaker for...
He's been wanting that for ages.
Yeah.
There's a rumour that it's either Drew or AJ's meant to face Hunter.
I know AJ's been wanting Triple H back.
He's been wanting Triple H for ages.
Yeah, definitely. Anyway, yeah, so top 5. You said Big E, Roman, Drew.
Kevin, KO, but then up and following Kevin Owens since his Ring of Honor days. And what else is good? Just new. Probably Sasha. she's probably like one of the only, because she's the only part, she's like one of the only females that's actually been carrying the division. It's like Becky's gone, and Becky's gone, so you've got nobody to watch. You add Charlotte back into the mix because you actually need a star. Asuka has not won the title clean since September. Every other title match has had, it's been either a DQ finish or a count-out finish, or some other 6 degrees of bullshit. And then if you look on the indie side, you've got all the boys in AEW. But then Eddie Kingston instantly speaks out. You've got John Moxley that instantly speaks out. You've got all the boys in Japan. So like your Akadas, your Ibushis, you've got like all the boys over there. And then the other person that's kind of a bit of a dark horse, and I probably see him either turning up in somewhere in Florida quite soon, is Jacob Fatu. So he's the current heavyweight MLW champion, and he's think about how Omega was against like Cena for the title back in like 06, 07 or somewhere like that.
No, I think it was 07. I think it was.
Yeah, but then he is related to the Anno. He's related to them somehow. I'm sure he's like a son or a cousin of. No, he's a cousin of Rikishi or some sorts. Like he did, like all the stuff he does in MLW. In MLW, you can go on YouTube for free. So he's had some pretty decent matches. Like he had a match with, what was he in matches? He's had matches with Davey Boy Smith. He's had matches with Low Key. He had a match with ACH last week, which was pretty decent. Like, why nobody? He's like, he's been in MLW for like 2-3 years, and I can't see why like WWE or AEW news been trying to sniffing about.
ACH is one of those guys where I can't keep forgetting his name's ACH. I just go, ah. It's
his name. Yeah. He had so much potential in WWE, though. He had so much potential.
I mean, I think there's better ways he could have handled. I mean, it wasn't...
There's a lot better ways he could have handled his situation.
Yeah, absolutely. I think all it needed was taking someone aside and going, look, this is insensitive.
I'm not happy.
Get rid of this.
But then, here's the thing. Before he went to WWE, he was in Ring of Honor, and then he did kind of rub folk up the wrong way there, because like Jay Lethal was the champ at the time. And then you had like Kenny King, you had Leo Rush start to get noticed, you had ACH, you had a lot of athletic African American lads who could any one of them have been champion, but then Jay Lethal's golden boy. And it's like, it was at the time Jay Lethal was like double champion. And it was like just after he'd come to, it was like just after he'd been in, it was like tag champs over here. It's like that sort of time frame.
Right, okay.
Just to confuse you even more.
Jay Lethal, former WrestleZone tag team champion.
Champion. The only thing you'll ever be known for.
Exactly.
Like, oh, no, that's it. It's like, oh no, he wasn't. He wasn't a multi-time Ring of Honor champion. He wasn't the only person to be the whole the Ring of Honor world and television champion at the same time. Oh, he didn't portray Macho Man and was like one of the best characters that's ever been in TNA or independent wrestling or American independent wrestling. Full stop.
Don't Oh, for wrestling tag team champion, and refused to take a picture with me because I wouldn't buy a signed picture. That's how I remember Jay Lethal. I'll forever remember him as that. Yeah. Much like as I'll ever refer to Ricochet as Trevor, because he introduced himself to me as that. So he is Trevor forever, forevermore. But this has been a very long, fascinating, random chat, I kind of expected it to be. But before we go, where can people find you on social media? Where can people find you on podcasts, everything? If someone wants to find you, where are they going to find you?
So podcast-wise, it'll be Last Fan Standing. Well, Last Fan Standing, Boom of the Button. Banter may return at some point, I don't know. But Last Fan Standing is probably where you can find us. Social media-wise... Facebook, look for the Cultaholic fan group, the WrestleTalk fan group. Even if you try and get into the Last Fan Standing Promo Federation, like, you'll find me there, mostly ripping the piss, mostly either doing something entertaining or ripping the piss, one of the two. It is mostly just number two. And Twitter-wise, I would say follow me. It's my normal Twitter, but then that's private. I'm trying to keep the YouTube and wrestling onto one Twitter news, so it's probably at Boom of the Banner. Capital B, capital O, capital T, capital B.
Excellent. Well, perfect. Well, thank you for joining me on today's Untitled Wrestling Podcast by SWN. Hopefully you've enjoyed it if you're listening. If you're watching it, you've obviously purchased it on Patreon, so thank you for that. We'll be eternally grateful. But yeah, once again, thank you for joining me today. You can say goodbye.
Bye.